Cause he is one, yeah, he is one. Many say there's others, but there is no one like him, no. His love lights the way, his truth will break down every lie. His children proclaim his name.
A couple of those songs were sort of new to us, and not really new to me. There's one of those songs Austin and I heard back in January at a Passion conference. So anyway, we're glad that they were able to lead us today in that. I just want to real quickly say, Dr. Brantley, I didn't mean to neglect you in that announcement. Because we know somebody has to pay for all the dresses, right, that are going to be bought for the granddaughter. So we don't want to neglect you in all of this. And I do want to just draw your attention to Mr. Buddy and Ms. Charlotte that are here today worshiping with us. They have had a rough year physically. Ms. Charlotte has gone through cancer and gone through treatments and all of that. And Mr. Buddy is awaiting surgery even now here in the next little bit. So I appreciate that you guys were able to make it this morning and worship with us. And we're praying for you. You're on our list. We pray for you every week. We just want to watch God restore your health and restore you guys through that. So we're glad that you're here to worship with us today as well. I probably shouldn't tell you this. Well, I guess I could tell you this part. I mean, I have really enjoyed this Thanksgiving holiday. But I probably shouldn't tell you this part, that there was a turkey that was severely harmed in the making of our Thursday lunch. I mean, it was severely harmed. It was fried and it was cooked, and he was delicious. And maybe you had the same experience there. There were several cows that have been sacrificed to make all the footballs that we've been watching for the last 3 days get thrown around the football field. And I don't know about you, but yesterday I pretty much watched football all afternoon up until about midnight last night. Was still watching football games. And so, but there were some people who had to pay the price for that. Obviously, there have been many thanks that have been prayed over the dinner table in the last few days. Some of you have had family that have come in from out of town. Some of you have all of your family already in town. And some of you, after about Thursday, about 3 o'clock, wanted to leave town. So you've been able to celebrate that Thanksgiving. I know that Monica took some pumpkins and reconditioned them into pumpkin bread and pumpkin pie. I'm not a big pumpkin fan, but Austin loves that pumpkin bread. And so she made him some of that. And just a lot of things have gone on these last 4 days. A lot of calories have been consumed. A lot of belts have been loosened. Several naps have been had. And I began to think, man, I love Thanksgiving. I really love Thanksgiving. And I thought, man, couldn't it be Thanksgiving all year long? And then I thought, well, you know what? Maybe it really should be. And I really have, I guess the last week when we've been talking with the youth at our house and Thanksgiving getting closer, and I've been thinking about Thanksgiving a lot. And here's what hit me the other day, that I'm the one who chooses to be thankful or not. Thankfulness is one of those things that you get to choose for yourself. You may not get to choose all the circumstances of your life for yourself. You may not be able to choose every detail of what's going on in your life. You may not be able to choose the chaos that's coming your way. You may not be able to choose all of the things that are going on around you. But you are the one, and I am the one, who get to choose for ourselves whether or not to be thankful. No one has to choose for me to be thankful. And in fact, no one can choose for me to be thankful. And so really the idea of Thanksgiving is it's a me problem. It's a you problem. It's a we've got to deal with that problem, because it literally comes back to us, whether or not we choose to be thankful. We've been doing this I Am series, and what I just said has nothing to do with that. That's just sort of a thought God's been sort of blowing up in my mind the last couple of weeks, and I just thought I'd share it. But we've been doing this I Am series, and all throughout Jesus' ministry on earth, he kept proclaiming who he was. He wanted the people to know him and to follow him and to get to believe in him and have faith in him. And so several times throughout the scriptures, he used the phrase, I am this, I am that. And so we start out in week one where Jesus said, I am the vine and you are the branches. And throughout that illustration that he used, he was trying to show the people and teach the people that with me, you could do anything. With me, nothing is impossible. But apart from me, you could do nothing. And if you've been a believer long enough and walked the journey long enough, you know that to be true. You know that there are things in your life that with God have happened, have been accomplished, that have been incredible. And there's no other way to explain it than God did that. God walked me through that. God got me through this toughest time of my life. God got me through that tough decision. God led me to this place. God, and then you also know there's times when you've tried to work it out yourself, right? And as you try to work it out yourself, you realize that really you may accomplish something physically, you may accomplish something financially, you may accomplish something, but as far as in the spiritual world, in your connection with Christ, and in your relationship with Him, apart from Him, we can do nothing. We looked the last 3 weeks at one particular verse where Jesus proclaimed three different things. He said, I am the way. And we live in a world today that almost says, shame on you for saying that he is the only way. And all I say to that is, I didn't say it, he did. And so if you want to argue, argue with him. If you want to debate it with him. He proclaimed, I am the way. He's not one of many ways. He's not a possible way you could choose. He's not a, if you would like that way, choose it. But there's lots of other ways. He is the way. And he proclaimed that of himself. And he said, no one comes to the Father but through me. He also said he was the truth. He said, I am the way, I am the truth. And we talked about the fact that one of Satan's biggest tools that he uses today is lies and deception. He used it back in the Garden of Eden with Adam and Eve. He's used it all throughout the scriptures. He's used it all throughout history. And he still tries to use it today. He still tries to lie to us, to deceive us, to distract us. And as he is battling with us in that realm, and he's trying to do that in your life and mine, it is important that we know the truth, that we are grounded in the truth of who Jesus Christ is, that we are grounded in the fact that Jesus is the truth, so that when the lies come our way, we can recognize them for lies. We can recognize them for deception. We can recognize what the enemy is trying to do to us. And then last week he said he is the life, and we talked about the fact that he is our eternal life. He is the center place of the scriptures. He is the new way from the old way. He, you know, the old way was the scapegoat and the law and the ceremonies and the sacrifices. And Jesus Christ has become the new way in our lives. And he does offer us eternal life, but he also offers us a new life. That the old can be passed away. All can be made new. He offers us a new life. Your past does not have to be your present. Your past does not have to define your future. Your past can be your past through Christ. And he offers us an abundant life. An abundant life, a satisfying life in him. And today we're going to continue on that journey of these I am statements that Jesus made. And before I dive into the meat of what I want to say today, I want to set a scene for you. I want to try to draw a picture for you. I'm not as good as some people who do that. But if we look into the scriptures, we see that there are some things happening here in John chapter 6. John chapter 6. Stephen, will you turn these lights up so I can read? Thank you. There we go. Thank you. John chapter 6, and let me just sort of draw the scene for you, and I'll just read a few verses here, starting in verse 1. It says, after this, Jesus crossed over to the far side of the Sea of Galilee, also known as the Sea of Tiberias. A huge crowd kept following him wherever he went, because they saw his miraculous signs as he healed the sick. Then Jesus climbed a hill and sat down with his disciples around him. It was nearly time for the Jewish Passover celebration. Jesus soon saw a huge crowd of people coming to look for him. Turning to Philip, he asked, "Where can we buy bread to feed all of these people?" And he was testing Philip, for he already knew what he was going to do. Philip replied, "Even if we worked for months, we wouldn't have enough money to feed them." And then Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. "There is a young boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what good is it? What good is that with all of this huge crowd?" So basically, this huge crowd is coming along, and Jesus sits down and he's teaching them, and it's time to eat. I mean, they're hungry. It's time for the Passover. And so Jesus is going to feed these people, and he's going to feed this huge crowd, and he's going to end up doing it with 5 loaves and 2 fishes that he gets from this little boy, a willing person who says, "Here, take my lunch. Do with it what you can." And if you know the story and you follow it, and again, this is sort of setting the scene for what's getting ready to come up, he's getting ready to do an incredible miracle. He's going to feed at least 5,000 people. In fact, we know it was more than 5,000. Because the scripture says there was 5,000 men there. So we know that there was females there, ladies there. We know that there were children there that were there. So more than 5,000 people he's going to feed with 5 loaves and 2 fishes. And so he does his miracle. He multiplies it. He causes it to grow. And to the point that the Bible says that all of them ate, everyone was full, and there were leftovers. Now, we don't want to talk about leftovers today, right? We're hoping the leftovers are long gone. We were talking about that earlier with somebody of like, after about 2 or 3 meals, it's time for the leftovers to be gone. But after all of this, 5 loaves, 2 fishes, he feeds everybody, he feeds over 5,000 people, and there's leftovers. That's an incredible miracle. If you don't believe it, go home and try it. It just doesn't happen. He did this incredible miracle here for these people. And it sort of draws the scene because if you look at the very end of this chapter, there's some verses that are very disturbing. Because it talks about disciples. And when we hear the word disciple, we think of the 12. But the reality is a disciple, by definition, is a follower of Christ. It's a follower of his teaching. It's a follower of who he was. And so in that day, part of the problem, part of the reason that they were after Jesus was because the number of his disciples were growing. And so the religious leaders were scared that, hey, he's going to become more popular than us. People are going to follow him more than us. People are going to follow his way more than our way, his teaching more than our teaching. And so they were scared that he was getting ready to take over. Because if he had the majority, if he had the crowd, if he had the people, then he could just literally obliterate them. And so these disciples are following him. And listen to what it says in the end of chapter 6. This is one chapter. And then we're going to go back to the middle and look at something that Jesus did. Many of his disciples said, "This is very hard to understand. How can anyone accept it?" Jesus was aware that his disciples were complaining, so he said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what will you think if you see the Son of Man ascend to heaven again? The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. And the very words I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But some of you do not believe me." For Jesus knew from the beginning which ones didn't believe, and he knew who would betray him. Then he said, "This is why I said that people can't come to me unless the Father gives them to me." Now get this. At this point, many of his disciples turned away and deserted him. So what happened between the first part of chapter 6, where this crowd is growing and he's doing this miracle and people are following him, to the end of chapter 6, where all of a sudden these people are saying, "This is too hard a teaching. This is, nobody could do this. Nobody could follow this." And they desert him. Well, several things happened in chapter 6, but what I want to look at today is what begins to happen in verse 22. This is where Jesus says, "I am the bread of life." And there's a lot in there that we're going to dig out today as far as why he used that illustration, why he was talking to them in those terms. In verse 22, he says this. It says, the next day, so yesterday he just fed these people. They ate out of 5 loaves of 2 fishes. They ate till they were full. They saw the leftovers get gathered up. They were all still there. The next day, the crowd that had stayed on the far shore saw that the disciples had taken the only boat, and they realized Jesus had not gone with them. Several boats from Tiberias landed near the place where the Lord had blessed, and the bread and the people had eaten. So when the crowd saw that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went across to Capernaum to look for him. In other words, they're going after him. They want to find him. And they found him on the other side of the lake and asked, Rabbi, where did you get here? Jesus replied, I tell you the truth. You want to be with me because I fed you, not because you understand the miraculous signs. The first point today from this passage is that Jesus is not a sideshow. These people had seen him do a miraculous sign. So what do? They get up the next day. They're like, let's go find that miracle worker. Let's go find that man. Let's go find that rabbi that I even refer to him as. And they go across and they find him. And what do they say to him? They go, hey, you know, what are you doing today? Well, what kind of miracles you got working up today? What you got on tap today? You gonna heal some folks? I love watching you when you heal folks. There's probably some people that came up and go, hey, man, you go do that whole water into wine thing? Because that would be all right. One guy probably came up, he said, you know what? He goes, I could eat. Well, what are you going to do today, Jesus? What miracle are you going to do today? You're going to feed us again? You're going to heal some folks? You're going to turn some water? What are you going to do today? Jesus was their sideshow. They just thought Jesus was just going to do all these miracles, and they missed the complete point of who he was. He wasn't a sideshow. He wasn't just a miracle worker. And I have this sentence down here, and I want you to think about this. Miracles move us, but Jesus Christ changes us. Miracles move us. I've watched many miracles happen in people's lives over the last 20 plus years. I have seen the person who the doctor says, oh, the tumor shrunk, the tumor's gone away. I've watched the family that was getting evicted because of their financial woes, and I've watched God put them in a house that was even better than the one they had. We had a teenager one year in our youth group, and her mom was a single lady, and we knew she struggled. She worked hard, but she struggled, and the daughter came to us and said, we're getting evicted this weekend. Do you think y'all could help us pack our stuff up? And so I got a few youth workers together that Saturday morning, and we went to their house, and it took us a long time to pack up their two-bedroom townhouse. And we said, now, where are we going to go? She goes, oh, I've got this place worked out for us that, you know, we can move to, and we can move there today. And so we have this truckload of furniture, and we drive out, and we're coming up Courtney Hodges Boulevard. And if you come up Courtney Hodges Boulevard, you know that right past Dairy Queen, there's a hotel on the right. And I'm sure that at one point in time, it was a beautiful hotel. It was a popular hotel. If you look at it today and you think in those terms, it probably had to be the 30s or 40s, because now it's a rundown motel. And so we're following her, and we turn into there. And so all of us sort of gasp like, oh my goodness. And she didn't even rent a room in the hotel, because in that hotel, if you drive around the back of it, down a little hill, it has basement. She had rented for her two daughters, a single mom rented for her two daughters, a concrete basement for them to move to. And I mean, we were all speechless. A couple of the ladies were like, well, we're not leaving her here. And one guy stepped up and said, yeah, I'm not unloading a single thing here. And in a matter of about an hour, some people begin to make phone calls, and some people begin to talk to people about getting some money together. And before the day was over, they had been taken from the two-bedroom townhome. Instead of going to this dungeon of a bay, I mean, literally, the only light in the place was a string light that you pulled like that in a light bulb hanging up in the middle. Every wall, the floor was concrete. I couldn't imagine. One of the things that the ladies, and you know, ladies think differently than men, one of the things that the ladies thought of, this girl has to get off the school bus every day by herself there and walk And it's just shady people there. I'm just telling you, it's a run down. Before the day was over, God had worked a lot of different things out. You talk about putting puzzle pieces together. And we unloaded their stuff in a three-bedroom house with rent that was cheaper than they had even been paying. And see, we see those miracles play out. We see that happen and we're like, oh my goodness. And we have tears that run down our face. We get excited. We start to tell people the story. But about a year later, that lady was in the same financial spot that she was in before. You see, the miracle was exciting. It moved her. But she needed Jesus Christ to change her. And that's the way these people were. They saw the miracles, but what they needed was Jesus Christ to change them. And that's what you and I need. We see miracles done, but we need Jesus Christ to change us. And that's what He wants to do. That's what His desire for you today is. That's why you're here today. Jesus Christ has a desire to change you. Not to leave you the same way that you've always been. I know most of you in here. I met a few new people today, but I know most of you. And I'm just here to tell you, none of us have arrived yet. None of us have made it to where we don't need any fixing yet. None of us have made it where we could say, Jesus, I got it. I'm done. I'm perfect. Jesus wants to change us daily. But He's not just a sideshow that we go to. God, I need a miracle. He wants to change us daily. The story moves on in verse 27. He has said this to these people. He said, but don't be so concerned about perishable things like food. Spend your energy seeking eternal life that the Son of Man can give you. See, He wants to change our lives. For God the Father has given me the seal of His approval. They replied, now get this, they replied, we want to perform God's work too. What should we do? Jesus told them, this is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one He has sent. They answered, show us a miraculous sign if you want us to believe in you. What can you do? The second point for today is that Jesus Christ is the foundation of our eternal life. Look at verse 29 there. He says, this is the only work God wants from you. Believe in the one He has sent. Jesus didn't need a miracle worker. He didn't need their works. He could do any miracle He needed to. He could perform anything that He needed to. He could supply anything that He needed to. He needed them. He wanted them to believe in Him. So often we complicate the Christian life. Sometimes we say, well, if I could sing like Gray, if I could look like Zach, if I could cook like Pat, if I could rock babies like Marissa, if I had all that, then I could really do something good for God. All He wants from you today is to believe in the one that has been sent from God the Father. All He wants from you, all His desire for you today is to believe in Him and believe in the eternal life that He has offered, that He has brought. He doesn't need our works. He doesn't need a miracle from you. He doesn't need you to pull off a miracle. He can do that. What He needs from you is belief, faith, trust. One of the songs that we just sang, and a couple of them were new, so I'm not even sure which song the words were in, but it talked about when the world's coming at you, let me know that I'm still, I think it was that last song, I'm still your son and daughter. You know, when craziness is going on, when your world's turned upside down, when the doctor calls and says you need to come in, when the boss calls and says you don't need to come in, when things are going crazy, when your landlord calls you and says, hey, we need to have a talk. Hey, when the world is crashing in, when the craziness is going on, what does Jesus need from you? He doesn't need a miracle from you. He needs you to believe. He needs you to have faith in Him. And that's what He wants from us today, is to believe in Him. To believe in Him. The story continues on, and this is where He gets to His proclamation. In verse 35, Jesus says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never be hungry again. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. But you haven't believed in me, even though you have seen me. These people had been with him and followed him and heard him and seen the miracles, and still some did not believe. Verse 37 says, however, those the Father has given me will come to me, and I will never reject them. For I have come down from heaven to do the will of God who sent me, not to do my own will. And this is the will of God, that I should not lose even one of those he has given me, but that I should raise them up on that last day. For it is my Father's will that all who see his Son and believe in him should have eternal life. He is the bread of life. Jesus is a master teacher. Think about this. The day before, he has just fed them bread. They have seen this bread multiply. They have seen this bread feed over 5,000 people. They have watched the miracle take place. They have seen the basket passed around with leftovers in it of the bread. They've watched this miracle. Not only that, but these particular folks, their ancestors had an incredible bread story. Because for years, God had fed them bread from heaven. God had fed them manna day after day after day after day. And it was their sustenance. It was their livelihood. I mean, it was what they lived off of. And that story was so great that it had been passed down from generation to generation. So these people knew about that story from way back when, from their grandparents. And then he just fed them bread. And what does he say to them? I am the bread of life. And he draws for this picture for them that at the very bottom level, at the very foundation, at the very center, at the very core of eternity is Jesus Christ. He is our eternal life. He is our bread of life. And it is in him and in him alone that we have eternal life. It is in him and his sacrifice on the cross that we have forgiveness of our sins. He says, I am the bread of life. Today, what Jesus says to you is, I don't need a miracle from you. I just need you to believe in me. I don't need you to do an incredible wonder that people would wonder about and say, wow, how could you do that? He just says, hey, I need you to believe in me. I need you to have faith in the one that God has sent. I need you to believe in the Son of God. And so today I ask you that. What are you doing today? Do you have that belief in God? Do you have that faith in the Son of God? Do you have the bread of life in your life? Or are you trying to work it out on your own? Try to get there your own way? Try to scoot in around the side? Folks, he says, I am the bread of life. I am the centerpiece of eternity. I am the foundation of your eternal life. Believe in me. So it says that some people at the very end of the story that I read a minute ago, they just said, this is too hard a teaching. You can be something in my life, Jesus, but you can't be everything in my life. This is just too hard for me to say, you know what? I'm just going to fully believe in you and fully trust everything in my life to you, Jesus. And so some turned and walked away. In fact, it even calls them disciples, right? So it's not maybe the 12, because he turns and talks to them as well, but it's these people who have been following him, following this miracle worker, looking for a miracle. What are you doing today, Jesus? And he says, believe in me. Believe solely in me. Believe, put all your faith in me. I am your eternal life. And some people said, I can't give you everything. So it says they turned and deserted. I know Rick Harris well enough to know that many times in my life, there have been those points where Jesus said, I want all of you. And there were times when I said, Jesus, you can have 75%. Jesus said, you could have, I give you 90. He said, I want all of you. Jesus, you could have, how about I make this deal with you, Jesus? How about I give you 50 now, and then when I get old and all my life is done, I'll give you all of it later, like a deferred plan. He says, I want all of you, Rick. And I believe today that one of the things that Jesus says to us is that I want all of you. He's not looking for a miracle from you. He's just looking for you to believe in Him, to have faith in Him, and to give Him your life. But would also believe that there are some that would say, you know what, Jesus, that's just too hard. And I believe that there's some that would just turn and walk away. Today, I don't know where you're at in that spectrum. But I would encourage you today that if you're one of those that is turning and walking away, that as the one song we sang, that the sinner would come back. That the sinner would return. That the one who's wandered away, the one who's wandered off from God's path, the one who's wandered off from that belief in Christ would be called back. But I also believe that today, maybe the saint needs to wake up. That was in that song as well. That the sinner would return, but the saints would wake up. And I believe that maybe there's many of us here today who know Christ as our Savior, but He's saying, I want 100%. I believe there's some in here today that He would say, look, I don't need you to work a miracle. I just need 100% of your belief. I just need your life in me, trusting me, following me, following after me. So I don't know where you're at in that spectrum, but today I want to encourage you that He is the bread of life. And in Him, we have everything that we need. In Him, we have every sustenance that we need. In Him, we have every resource that we need. So if you've wandered off, if you've turned and walked away, return. If you're here today and God's speaking to your heart and He says, I want all of you, I'm just telling you, give it to Him. Let's pray.